All right, guys, welcome to Wide Awake Radio. I am your host, Charlie McGrath. My website is wideawakenews.com. I want to thank everybody because we're about to cross 2 million hits on the unique hits on that website. And, guys, that's unbelievable. I keep forgetting to mention that, but I greatly appreciate everybody coming back day after day and checking the updates we do there. And a lot of you have become citizen reporters, journalists in your own right, sending material that we're posting up there as well. So thank you for your continued support. 155 people in chat, wideawakenews.com. Jump on inside there. Reginald and I are going to get into it here on SOPA. We're going to get into it on the Piracy Act. We're going to get into it on what Chris Dodd has to say about it. You know, even though Dodd-Frank, right, we're still dealing with this guy who brought us the collapse of 2008, who brought us Dodd-Frank, and then like a good, smart rat, fled the ship before it completely sank. Then he went to work for his buddies in Hollywood, and he's trying to get this SOPA pass. We're going to talk about that a little bit. I did a video last night, and I want to thank everybody who watched that and commented on it. I'm going to give the highlights of this video game because it's relevant when we start talking about SOPA and how it looks like it's going to die in the vine, right? It looks like there's going to be enough outrage that they're not going to pass this thing. But we must stay ever vigilant on what's going on, what's being done legislatively to us in Washington, D.C., because it was just a few weeks ago when we had the president sign under the cover of the holiday weekend in NDAA 2012. And he signed this thing, and because of the pressure of alternative media and even mainstream media, he issued a signing statement in which he basically said he wouldn't use NDAA 2012 in order to usurp the constitutional rights of the citizens of this country. So it wasn't even 2 weeks later when we have Congressman Dent come up with this legislation, H.R. 3166, and Joel Lieberman come up with S. 1698, which is the Enemy Expatriation Act. And this piece of legislation, extremely vaguely worded, can allow the government to strip you or any other United States citizen your citizenship, therefore the full weight and rendition of NDAA 2012 can be applied to you. So we see how they operate, right? We're seeing how they come up with legislation, they run it up the flagpole. If there's outcry from alternative media, who cares? They do what they're going to do anyway. If the outcry is so large that it sparks mainstream media to come on board and groups to look at it and say this is completely and totally a usurpation of liberty and a destruction of the Constitution, so they back off of it a little bit, but they always come back. They always are pushing and pushing. And I believe the number one threat, as Bob Chapman said last night, the number one threat to the powers that be is the incredible power of people speaking out. And it might be a couple thousand people listening to this program on rinse. It might be, you know, 10, 20, 30,000 people watches Reginald's videos. But this is a viral movement that we have inside of YouTube and inside of alternative media. And it is waking people up. And I think it's very much was not anticipated by the power elite. They thought they could just, you know, get us into the right chute, the red chute or the blue chute, especially in election season. And it's not working. They lost it when they tried to co-opt the Occupy movement. They tried to make this into a blue event, and they realized that, you know, the people of the Occupy, the majority of the people in the Occupy movement, were saying, you know what, to hell with you. We're not buying into your blue state, blue team garbage. We're not buying into this notion that we're going to give you another shot at it and you're going to fix the problem. We want real change, and we want it now. People are waking up to the truth. They're seeing through the lies, and so something like SOPA or this Piracy Act is here to stay. They're going to keep pounding this until they get their way. They want to be able to, the premise of this, and I'm going to, Reginald, also known as Dimcad from YouTube, welcome to the program again. Let me get you in here because I want to talk about the premise of SOPA. You know, this act, SOPA Act, you know, it's meant to protect intellectual property, and I can't think of anything more disingenuous than seeing an alleged representative come on television or the internet talking about how we have to do this because it's going to protect and save millions of jobs. And here we sit in a country that has no problem dismantling a manufacturing base, dismantling the intellectual property of a lot of our industry, and shipping it overseas because it increases profit on the bottom line of a lot of these too-big-to-fail firms, but they're using this as the reason to sell SOPA. It's unbelievable that it garnered the support that it did, but I'm very grateful that a lot of big corporations, such as Google, Wikipedia, they're all going to go dark tomorrow for a period of time to protest this legislation. So, I mean, this is a little bit of good news in this fight of this soft tyranny. Would you agree?
Absolutely. At first, they tried to – it was a union of record companies and movie studios supposedly to try to give the government the power to shut down certain websites that were deemed to be violating copyright laws. If they were offering illegal programs or anything that was stolen from a record company or perhaps a movie studio, they were designing this to give the government the ability to sort of shut those sites down by going to the ISPs, the internet service providers, and telling them that you have to block this website and block that website. Now, of course, the problem with that would have been, you know, how would you determine whether one particular site was responsible for piracy, or and who would have the ability to create the criteria for who you exclude, which sites get blocked, and how would you prevent the government from using this power to block certain websites that didn't offer any copyright material and was simply speaking out politically against the government? It was a big potential for abuse of power. And, you know, the question here was, how far was the government willing to go, and how far were we going to let them go?
Right.
So that was the whole premises behind it all. Now, in reality, if they were really worried about that the movie theaters and the movie companies and studios are really worried about their bottom line, they would simply improve the movie-going experience. You know, you're not going to sue your way into economic relevance. So I think last year they had the lowest attendance for movie theaters in about 16 years.
Right.
The problem wasn't so much I don't think it was so much movie piracy, people downloading movies off the internet. The problem is that so many crappy movies are being released, and the movie-going experience was pretty terrible. Like, who wants to pay $10 to see a movie, then pay another $10 or so on really expensive snacks, end up in some theater where people playing with their cell phone, talking on their cell phone, making loud noises? Who wants to pay for something like that? But anyway, that was the whole premises behind it. This was something that was being used by other people in the government to expand government power, and people are pushing back.
Yeah, absolutely. And the you know, here's the thing. We heard the same things. I'm old enough to remember going from cassette tapes to CDs and then MP3, and there was this. There's always this fear that the new thing is going to be corrupt, and it's going to, you know, MP3s are going to do away with the music industry. And, you know, instead of some of these industries adapting and taking advantage of it, you know, which some have done, especially in the world of MP3s, nobody even buys CDs anymore. You know, they go pay a dollar for every song that they want, or they have a shopping cart so they can buy what they want from iTunes. But instead of adapting to the situation, it's always a lot easier, right, for these titans of industry, in this case the movie industry, to go ahead and implement legal-based capitalism. Instead of adapting, instead of innovating and coming
up with a better product.
Yeah, come up with a better product and a better way to distribute the product, a more safe way to distribute the product, because it's like you said, you know, sometimes you just don't want to go to the theater and watch a movie, especially if you've shelled out all kinds of money for, you know, the latest flat-screen TV, and you're looking for a relaxing weekend with a girlfriend or wife or whatever, and you don't want to go sit and be annoyed for 2 hours in a movie theater. But instead of adapting and figuring out how to deliver a better product in a better format, which there definitely are ways to do that. Companies have made billions of dollars, and industries have been born adapting to new technology. They want to use the financial-based and legal-based capitalism in order to sue everybody, like you said, sue prosperity. But that shouldn't be a surprise to us, because that is the model for the so-called capitalist system that we have in this country. It's not more capitalist, you know, than the Cuban economic system or the former Soviet economic system. You know, it's capitalist by name only. But the reality of it is only the chosen, too big to fail, that have enough money to grease the wheels of Washington, D.C., will have the legislation that they write be turned into law that benefits them. Meanwhile, everybody else can just be a cog, a spectator in the world of financial-based and legal-based capitalism. So I'm glad to see we're going to have a host of people go dark tomorrow. I believe I'm trying to look at this list now. Wikipedia, Google. Who's partaking in this, Reginald?
Oh, well, I know it's Wikipedia and Google, but there are some other websites that I've heard of. I pretty much forgot about it at this point. But there's a lot going on in terms of the whole blackout. And I just want to remind people, radio was supposed to be a major problem for the music industry.
That's right.
They were really, really worried about radio. It sounds ridiculous, but when it first came out, they were scared to death about radio. There was a lot of rhetoric about how radio was going to hurt the industry. It was going to make it too easy for people to have access to the music. Now it's a big part of the entire industry, you know. As far as movies, let me tell you something. When it was $6, or $5 for me to see a movie, I saw movies even though the reviews weren't even that great. Like, for example, at Rotten Tomatoes.com, if the rating is 60%, 60% of the critics agree with it and think it's a good movie, then it's fresh, 60% or more. If it's below that, it's considered being a Rotten Tomato. Fresh Rotten Tomato. Yeah, it's a pretty good site, but, you know, even when the movies were only had 70% or 60% ratings, you know, I didn't mind seeing movies when they were at $5 or $6 because it was only $5 or $6. But when you start getting up at $8.50, you know, your expectations sort of change. If you see a movie, you know, and it's not really all that great, then it's going to affect your patterns, your behavior patterns. I was more likely to see two movies when it was only $6 than to show up for an $8.50 type of movie. I mean, that's psychologically, it has an impact on people. So they have to look at the ticket prices. You can only raise them so much, you know. So these are just some other things.
Yeah, it turns into an event. I mean, you know, it's getting to the point, and I don't even, I mean, $8.50, you know, last time I was in Denver, I think it was $10. Go ahead.
Yeah, you have to offer something there. When I was in Alaska, in Anchorage, I went to something called a Bluetooth theater where they served you pizza, nachos, and beer, and wine, and all kinds of stuff while you watched an indie movie. And that was a pretty good experience. But now you have to pay, what, $6 for popcorn and a drink? What, they want to charge you $3 for soda? I mean, soda's like the cheapest product you can possibly sell. You want to charge me $3 for soda? I mean, it's completely insane.
Absolutely.
It's not even a good movie-going experience.
No, you better be getting something more than, you know, when you're dropping, you bring you and your best gal to a movie, and you're dropping $50, man, I'd rather spend that money go having a decent meal. All right, I want to segue. Do you have anything more you want to add to the Piracy Act or so? But do you think we'll see it snuck back in?
They'll try.
Yeah.
I mean, look what happened with the Obamacare. Look what happened with NDAA. They're going to keep pushing that crap. If they can get away with it, they will.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I want to get a little bit into the debate last night. Guys, we have 161 people in the chat room. Somebody's imitating Dimcat in there. Okay, now it's Dimcat fan. But you always bring a lot of fans to the program, Reginald. But Dimcat is in there, and you know it's him, because his smile and face is next to his name in there. Guys, if you're listening, you want to join these folks in there, wideawakenews.com. I am Dimcad, yeah. Click on the Wide Awake Radio button. You can put topics or suggestions or questions in there for myself or for Reginald. We'll pull them out of there during the program. Did you watch the debate last night, Reginald?
No, I can't do it. I can't. I don't see the point.
Yeah.
I mean, what am I watching exactly? I've heard enough of these guys. You know, Mitt Romney, Newt Gingrich, Rick Santorum.
Yep.
I mean, I've heard these guys before. I've heard the rhetoric. I mean, these are guys who've never fought a day in their lives, whether it be in the streets or in the military. But they're always the first ones talking about, let's bomb somebody.
Absolutely.
I don't take these guys seriously.
There's two points I want to comment on that debate. Guys, I stayed up, you know, I had to watch the repeat of it, which came on here, I think, at 10 o'clock, and it was 2 hours. So I stayed up and I watched the entire thing, and I'm like Reginald. I despise it. I wish I could fast-forward it to the Ron Paul parts, but that would defeat the purpose of why I'm watching it. I want to see what the rhetoric is. I want to see what direction it's going. And you can always tell what the handlers are gearing them towards, trying to gin up certain segments of the population. and it really depends on where they're at on what the main topics will be. And it's if you don't think this thing's scripted, then you know you need to wake up, because there's only one of those guys up there who's absolutely not following his script, and that is Ron Paul. You watch these guys, and you see that it's going to be the same answer from every single one of them. And it's always going to be generated towards the Republican base that is in front of them. It was South Carolina last night, a lot of military influence there. And so that's what we saw. You know, we saw, pro-war, pro-killing, put a bullet in him. I mean, it's like these guys are in a video game or something. You know, they're in modern warfare. They want to talk about assassinating leadership, and it's a good thing that we kill people, and the best thing for these guys is a bullet in the head. My God almighty, these are the people who are going to be the leaders of the most advanced, capable military on the planet, and they're talking about how it's cool that they go around putting bullets in people's head. And, you know,
they never had to do anything in their entire lives, okay? They've never been in the military. They've never been in real – I doubt these guys have even been in any type of street fights, any type of fights on the playground, at school. These guys don't do any fighting. You can tell. They're always running their mouth about dropping bombs and killing this person and killing that person. They haven't done anything, okay? I've heard these guys in various debates running their mouths about this and that. You know, I remember in one debate, Gingrich was talking about how, you know, he knows what it's like for these military families to go through this and that, and how his father was in the military. I don't care what your father did, and how he didn't go to war because he had a wife and a kid.
Yeah, blah, blah, this.
And then Ron Paul says that one quick thing. When I was called up, I had a wife and a kid, and I went. And it was just like this dead silence.
Yeah. He's making so much money, he doesn't know what to do with it all over there on YouTube. That's kind of a joke, because I get accused of being a money-making, money-grubbing moneymaker from YouTube. And I know Reginald's not getting rich on YouTube. We're talking politics. We talked SOPA in the first half. We started talking a little bit about the debate last night. Reginald and I and the 70 folks on JTV talked a little bit about it during the break. So let's get back into that. If you left the chat room, we dwindled down to 1:45. If you want to get back in there, we're going to be pulling topics out of there probably for the rest of the hour. Go to wideawakenews.com, click on the Wide Awake Radio, and the Justin TV feed is in there if you want to watch that as well. Reginald just educated me. This vote in South Carolina is Saturday. I did not know that. I thought it was coming up this Tuesday. So I guess we were talking during the break about why, you know, Reginald asked me, you know, why are you watching this exactly? And I said, I want to see the pandering to segments of the base, and depending where they're at, you know, if they're up in the Midwest or in a more affected area where there's a lot more unemployment, you'll hear all this talk about, you know, how Obama let the minorities down and destroyed the economy. If he's down in a military region, it's war, 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 kill, kill, kill. The best thing we ever did was allegedly kill Osama bin Laden and kick him off the side of a ship in the middle of the night when everybody was on lockdown in the ship. I'm waiting for the moment that the full-out class war begins in this country. And you can mark my words, it's coming sooner rather than later. We saw a little bit of it last night, I think, with Santorum. He started talking about the people on unemployment and vaguely veiled his disdain for these people who are on 99 weeks. I thought it was disgusting that Bret Baier, who for Fox News, who I've always kind of thought of him as one of the more fair folks over there with his question asking, talked about how the 99ers and alluded that the people who are 99ers on unemployment are the 99ers that are out in mass with the Occupy movement. And so we're starting to see this correlation, this drawing the line where the red team is supposed to be on the side of big business and the blue team is going to have all these unemployed losers, and it's going to be their fault. And that will be the dialogue coming into the battle between whoever the GOP nominates and Obama. That all falls apart. That all disintegrates. This battle plan goes to pot in a second if Ron Paul ends up being the nominee, because even as somebody on Fox panel last night pointed out, you know, he's farther to the perceived left on military spending and projection of empire than the current president is, and that's 100% correct. But it isn't a perceived left. He's closer to the Constitution than anybody that potentially will be the next president other than himself. He's
what left?
What's that?
What left?
Well, the
I mean, it doesn't make any sense to me. What left? I mean, Obama, he's supposed to be to the left.
You're right.
And he expanded the war in Afghanistan. He continued the war in Iraq. And now we have we don't have mercenaries in Iraq. We're not sending mercenaries there. We're sending private contractors there. And then he had Libya, a completely unnecessary war. Now, I mean, what left? I mean, that's what I don't get. I mean, these guys, some fake left, fake conservative, fake liberal, they're both supporting the same neocon policy, and it just drives me crazy. Sorry.
No, you're right. You're 100% right. See, and that's what more people need to point out, and that's why we point this kind of thing out. Obama isn't left. You know, he's doing the exact same thing on just about every single front as Bush did. And now if you got up on stage and said that last night, then, you know, you would be booed off the stage for stating reality. You know, but if you look at what's going on with the financial system, you know, it's doing the exact same thing it did under Bush, which is the never-ending bailouts, protecting the too big to fail, making sure that they are completely whole and healthy while everybody else is made to suffer. If you look on the military front, we're doing the exact same thing Bush did, except, as Reginald just pointed out, it's even worse. We still have secret prisons. We still have secret torture camps. We still are waging wars hand over fist. We're still poking people into war like we are with Iran. And, you know, it isn't getting better. It's getting worse. So if a Republican is nominated and a Republican or if the Republican nominee is made president, then all of a sudden we'll see Code Pink and we'll see the anti-war protesters be allowed back on TV. Just so we can maintain this balance, you know, so we can have this balance between the red team and the blue team being able to fight amongst each other to skirt through another 4 years of, you know, protecting the financial institutions and protecting the military-industrial complex. And that's why I said the whole plan implodes if Ron Paul is nominated, because he's not going to listen to a bunch of handlers tell him, well, we got to be strong on war, we got to be strong on, you know, this preemptive doctrine that we've brought forth in the last decade. He's going to be, we're returning to the Constitution. We're going to close down a bunch of these bases. We're not going to invest trillions of dollars in military spending. We're going to invest our money in defense spending, a major difference between the two. And we're going to mind our own business and rebuild our own country. Which is a terrifying reality. Knowing this, it tells you, or it should tell you, that anything and everything will probably be done to keep him from gaining any more momentum than a quarter of the vote. Reginald, the interesting thing that I see coming forward in the next few months is a lot of people think that he will not run as a third-party candidate. Now, I know he said he doesn't want to, but he hasn't outright said that he won't. But if he ends up with the kind of momentum and the kind of numbers that show, you know, he garners a third of the people he talks to, 30% or so, I hope he does go out and run as a third-party candidate. I think he could actually win as a third-party candidate when people truly hear his message. And with alternative media, with the Internet, and with his ground game that he has, I think they would reach more people via alternative means in this election than ever before, and in fact would reach as many people as the mainstream media does. Your thoughts?
Well, I mean, you really don't want to hear my thoughts on Ron Paul will not be the next president of the United States, in my opinion. I don't think he'll be the nominee. Even if people were smart enough to realize that the Republicans and Democrats were corrupt, and even if this guy won enough elections and he had more delegates than anybody else, I'm sure they'll get to the convention and they'll find a way to make sure they switch the delegates to somebody else. That's how corrupt I think this system really is, even if he did win more elections. And even if he did ran as a third-party candidate, as long as he ran well enough that he didn't actually have a chance to win, they will be okay with it. All right?
Yeah.
It would be fine. If he had 25%, fine. Obama gets reelected, whatever. If this guy actually gets 35% and actually has a chance at getting elected, well, let me put it to you this way. When I have a lot on the line, when people have a lot on the line, you think they're just going to let somebody take it away from them? You think the CIA, you think the entire structure all these corporations making money off of these wars are just going to let all this money go down the drain over an election? I mean, one way or another, I'll just leave it at that.
No, I know what you're saying. And, you know, they'll take them out is what you're saying. You know, go ahead.
Well, I mean, anything's possible, but frankly, I think there may be another. I don't know if there's going to be like some JFK type of scenario, but I mean, the guy's 76 years old. You know, he could easily have a heart attack, and people would buy that. So, you know, anyway, too many people have too much to lose.
Right,
it has to be other than an establishment person in there. That's just my opinion. I could be wrong. If you guys can prove me wrong, I would love to see Ron Paul win so many elections, and he has more delegates than other guys, and have to outright broker a convention to show you how corrupt they really are and say that he can't be the nominee.
Right. How can I argue with that? I mean, that would be like me saying that there's no corruption in Washington, D.C. There's no corruption on Wall Street. There's no collusion between Wall Street and Washington, and these guys don't fight tooth and nail to take everything they possibly can. We know that's the truth. You know, the hope is that Ron Paul does what he continues to do, what he's doing, which is waking more people up than ever thought possible in alternative media. The more he talks, the more momentum he gains, the more people that hear his message and start to discount what the mainstream media has painted him as, which is, you know, tinfoil hat wearing whatever, the better. And then when and if something like that did happen. If that happened, Reginald, can you imagine if that happened, if they took him out, and regardless if it, you know, if it made it look like an accident or a car crash or whatever, can you imagine what would happen in this country?
Here's a smarter way to get rid of Ron Paul. Find somebody with the same type of message. Who's younger, who delivers it in a different way, and that way you can split that vote. And then get rid of all your other neocon candidates. So you just have the one neocon candidate like a Romney, and you have the Ron Paul and the Ron Paul light to sort of split the Ron Paul vote. Then you neutralize that and prevent him from getting the nomination.
That's how I think. Who's Ron Paul light? I mean, are you picking somebody? I guess it would have to be a Republican. So, you know, and trust me, you're right. If let's pretend Romney gets the nomination, as it looks like he's going to. If it ended up being, you know, a heated race into the GOP nomination, and they had, you know, wrangling in order to get Romney to be the candidate or be the nominee, you would see him change his message. He would grab on to what Ron Paul saying, just like we saw a lot of these people grab onto the message of audit the Fed and look at what Wall Street's doing and clamp down on Wall Street. And they grabbed onto this message because it was a Tea Party message. But you see what happens when they try to do this and own it, and it's not genuine, and it's not from their heart. They fall apart. You know, Michelle Bachmann, she came out talking about, you know, she wanted to go after Wall Street. She wanted to go after the Federal Reserve and clamp down on what they're doing. But it didn't pan out because I personally believe she didn't believe what she was saying. She saw it as an opportunity to gain support and gain momentum for her agenda. You know, she's a tax lawyer by trade before she entered into Congress. You know, when it's not authentic and it's not backed by years and years of conviction, it would fall apart. But I can certainly see Romney grabbing on to that message or trying to grab on to some of Ron Paul's ideas and making him his very own. He's turned out to be absolutely masterful at changing his position because he's done it on multiple things.
No, he's not about anything. I mean, I don't even have to agree with the guy on all the issues. It's just the fact that he consistently changes his ideas to almost fit whatever the crowd is. You know, it's like if you're going on a tour across the country and you were singing country songs in the South and rap songs in New York State. That's what Mitt Romney is. Wherever he goes, he just sings. He just sings whatever song he thinks the audience will like. That's Mitt Romney to me.
That's all of them. I'm gonna make an announcement.
He does it extreme.
Yeah. Well, you know, he's focus grouped to death. He's got perfect hair. He's got just the right amount of gray. His teeth have never been whiter in his life. and they've expunged everything that he's ever done. You know, he heads this corporation that guts companies, sells them, and you know, relies on a government bailout just to save the pension funds. Meanwhile, he's shoveling hundreds of billions of dollars into the pockets of the investors. That is not capitalism. That's not capitalism. And you know, I get hacked on sometime from a lot of the folks that are in the Occupy movement because I say I am a capitalist. But what they're, you know, a lot of these younger guys are brought up thinking capitalism is what we see going on in this country, and it isn't. Not at all. Not even by any stretch of the imagination. We have a command economy. We have a system that rewards failure and makes institutions completely and totally systemic, and it makes it a complete disadvantage for anybody who's not bought into the system. So, you know, the whole thing, in my opinion, the best thing that could happen is him either getting the nomination or running third party and exposing this complete corrupt system for what it is. Reginald, I want to get on to, I'd put to the room, we have about 140 people in there, put in your questions and comments, and World War III keeps coming up. I found it, and I want to get into this topic a little bit. We have about 8 minutes left or so. We have Iran, I don't know if you saw this story today, Iran is giving back the drone, the secret CIA drone aircraft that they captured. And then when you read this story, you'll find out some entrepreneur inside of Iran decided to make little 1/80th scale drones and sell them as novelty gifts. So they said they're gonna make a pink one and send it back to the president. But, it, you know, all kidding aside, it seems to be that, you know, Iran is the enemy of the day. And, you know, we had Bob Chapman on here last night, and I kind of gathered from him he thinks it's going to be kicked down the road a bit further, maybe a few more years before we actually get in there. I don't. I really don't. I think we've had five assassinations of Iranian scientists over the last couple of years. We've seen things like the drone shoot down. We know we're going in there and violating their airspace by sending these drones in. We are attacking their banking system with National Defense Authorization Act 2012. We're coercing our partners into embargoing their oil. We're doing everything that you would do to provoke a nation to doing something that would be the excuse to go ahead and launch a military engagement. Now, maybe Bob's right, and we're going to sail through 2012, and things are going to be just moderately okie-dokie, where we have a 1% or 2% GDP growth, and there won't be a need for the distraction of Iran. I don't believe that. I think Europe is going to come back into the forefront as being the problem child that it is, and I think Iran will be the massive distraction in order to hide all the economic problems of the world, because when Europe goes, so will the U.S. Your thoughts?
Well, you know, unless there's a terrorist attack, they say it's Iran, I don't think it's going to be this year. Unless you hear something about the U.S. dollar and oil. You hear something about them trying to sell their oil in euros or something, and we're going to war. We're definitely going to war under that scenario. Because with Saddam, he decided to try to sell that oil in euros, war. Gaddafi decided to go independent from the IMF and set up his own systems of communication and try to sell his oil in a gold-backed currency and not the dollar, war. So anybody in the Middle East who tries to sell their oil in something other than the dollar better be ready for war, and I think that's going to be a war if that happens for sure. Until I see that, I'm not going to worry about it too much. War is the direction we're going.
Let me worry you a little bit, because in 2008, Iran declared they were no longer going to trade their oil in U.S. dollars. Now, they had a caveat there. They had exclusions for China, for Russia, for India, a lot of nations who had very large dollar reserves. Now, in the past month, they had a meeting between these nations, these key nations, and Iran, where they made an agreement to no longer use the dollar. This came right on the heels of NDAA 2012 being signed and this attack on the Iranian Central Bank being implemented. They had a meeting and they decided that no longer They would abide by the original 2008 decree. Now they will trade oil in whatever the currency is of the country that's doing business, or in the Iranian currency, but no longer they use U.S. dollars. That story came out maybe a week ago, maybe a week and a half ago, and it was validated by multiple different sources. Very little U.S. press coverage, but it had a lot of coverage in European press. So, I mean, you're right. I agree with you 100%. As long as they're, you know, not hurting the Federal Reserve System and the globalist banking system, they will be allowed to just be the whipping boy of the world. But I think they've crossed that line.
Oh, well, then we're going to war sooner than I thought.
Yeah, well, you know, it'll just be a continuation.
Well, I think there's definitely going to be a big war. I don't know if it's going to be World War III, but generally when you have these big economic downturns, at least about 8 or 10 years later, you have big wars. You know, you look at World War I and World War II. Now, yeah, you look at the Depression, and soon after that, it takes a little while, but then there's a really big war. So, I mean, that's what tends to happen when these economies go south. War tends to be a solution that governments turn to. Absolutely. So I don't know what type of war, but I think there's going to be a really big war, a war that requires a lot of people involved.
Yeah, and that, you know, we talked about that a little bit last night, too, that Bob, and as well as Warren, him and I talked after, thinks that we'll see conscription again here in the U.S. I hope we do see a war. I hope it's a war of civil unrest and peaceful pushback and noncompliance, because that. Go ahead.
Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, I'm done. It's all you, Warren.
Oh, well, that'll be interesting. Having a draft. I mean, that'll be really interesting. I mean, how well will that go over, really?
Well, I don't think it's going to happen. And my theory is that we already have a draft. It's called a depression. And it's called 80% of kids graduating college and moving back in with mom and dad. I don't think there's any shortage of volunteers because you can go in and get a paycheck and a pretty decent paycheck, especially if you have a college degree and you become an officer. It's one of the better options that there is right now for finding a job straight out of school or right out of high school even. So I don't think we'll need a draft unless we enter into worst case scenario, you know, and it's somebody put in the chat room, China and Russia are the allies of Iran. You know, if you start getting all those guys into the mix, then forget it. I mean, I don't, you know, it could go from zero to nuclear in, you know, 2 seconds. So if we see the vast global world war again, then yeah, we'll see a draft. But if we just keep on with this skirmishes that we are engaging around the world, I think there's plenty of volunteers because there's little else to do.
Well, they're going to need a much bigger military than they have right now if they want to fight World War III. They're already spread out across the whole world. They're going to need a draft. They're going to need a lot more soldiers for World War III, depending on what type of war it is. Maybe because it's more electronic, more technological, more computer-based, they don't need as many soldiers, but I think our military is already stretched pretty thin.
Without a doubt. And, in fact, that was brought up on the stage last night.